know what really makes us mad? Is wasting money on CDs with only one or two good songs.
Yeah. Tell them about punk.
What's up, posers? Welcome to Punk Lotto Pod, the game where no one wins. I'm your co-host, Justin Hensley.
I am your other co-host, Dylan Hensley.
And today we are joined by a special guest. So please tell us who you are and what you do.
Hi, I'm Zia. And I'm calling from the beautiful city of Philadelphia. And I am a former pop punk bass player and also a pro wrestling photographer.
Yeah, that's awesome. You were in the band Paramedic.
Yes, yes, and we became a band called Bear Hug.
Oh,
and okay. Yeah, we made some pretty terrible pop punk jams.
Well, I listened to that the split you did with Sprainer today to remind myself what the band sounded like, and those songs were great. And it's funny, there's a song on there about Yokozuna, right? It's the song title mentions Yokozuna.
Oh yeah.
And I was like, oh, that's like a perfect intersection right there, wrestling and punk.
I know. We had big ideas. Well, I think we were a three-piece, and two of us were really into wrestling, and the other guy was not into wrestling. And at one point, we had like a transition where we got a new drummer, and I was really trying to change the name of the band to Gorilla Monsoon, and everybody... Nice. And it was shut down hard. But I think that we just loved pop punk, and we were... just like rediscovering our love of wrestling. And we had a lot of big ideas. We have like a song where we put some Colt Cabana, like commentary in there too. So there's lots of hidden pop punk gem. Pro wrestling gems buried in those pop punk songs. So,
yeah. And I want to say, I'm trying to think of how I found out you were a photographer for wrestling. I want to say Square of Opposition maybe shared online that like you had a page on Facebook for wrestling.
Oh, and, yeah.
And that's how I started following you. And then I bought that Hardway Volume 3 a couple months ago, and I saw you had some pictures in there. I was like, she'd probably be perfect to talk to for this show.
Yeah, thank you so much for thinking of me. Yeah, I was so excited to be a part of that Hardway zine. It's really cool. The guy who puts it together, Michael Watson, is just like so endlessly talented. So,
is he also the one who did the Mind Games mag too, or he just has some pictures in there?
No, I think that he's just a contributor to Mind Games, but he put out this really rad book of Polaroids of wrestlers.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm, and it's really good. If you haven't seen it, you should definitely check it out. I can send you a link. But
yeah,
he's just doing really interesting. I think him and I just kind of got joined up because we're both just trying to shoot pro wrestling as art, like as an art form. So
yeah, you I've seen a lot of your pictures. You take a lot of pictures of Ring of Honor wrestling and a lot of Chikara, it looks like, too.
Yeah, I started in Chikara. I think I started in Chikara in like 2008. And I just started going on the road with them. And it was almost like being in a band. It was funny. Wow. We would just like, I would hop in a car and we'd go to Toronto and I'd sleep in a floor, like on a floor. And we'd go to VFW halls and I would shoot pictures of like the pancake breakfast they would clean up before they would set up the wrestling ring. And
so,
from there, I just kept photographing. I just loved it. And then I got hooked up with companies like Chikara and Beyond and lots of other indie feds on the East Coast.
Yeah, and your stuff's great. Like, you've got that on your website. Like, the first one you see is that El Generico on the bleachers, and just really great stuff. And I've always noticed there is like a parallel between like indie wrestling and like punk rock, and a lot of driving around, not getting paid what you should.
Yeah, exactly. It's so similar. It's really uncanny. The different, like the similarities between like a basement show and an indie wrestling show in like a high school gymnasium. It's the same plane of existence.
Yeah. Well, cool. I guess we can get into the show, unless, Dylan, you have anything you want to say?
No.
Nothing new.
Yeah.
Pretty standard week for me, so.
Cool. Well, all right. So, for this episode, I guess I should actually explain the premise of the show. I missed that at the top. So, this is the show where, using the Rate Your Music punk charts and a number generator, we choose one album and one EP at random to discuss. For this week's episode, we got the year 2000. Guess I should plug in that Conan O'Brien bit here.
Mm-hmm, you should.
I'm not sure who remembers that joke. I guess.
Oh, I do for sure. This is my wheelhouse.
Yeah, I was watching those when they were new, so yeah. I don't know what our audience is age wise, but
getting in trouble staying up late watching Conan O'Brien.
That was a golden time for Conan, really. The late 90s, early 2000s. There's some gems.
Yeah. There's some great stuff there. So, year 2000. Looking at the charts, what jumps off? I guess number one right there, we should mention.
Number one, speaking of late night television.
At the drive-in.
Yeah, this is a big album. A lot of my friends, this is like one of their top albums, I feel like.
Isn't it weird that this was like a radio hit?
It doesn't make sense to me. I don't remember it as a radio hit.
I remember it playing on our local radio station, like the Modern Rock station here, and it's a station that primarily consisted of like alternative rock. So it did well, I think. It was an MTV thing for sure. Yeah.
I mean, they were on Conan, they were on Letterman too.
Wow, they were on Letterman? I'm going to look that up later.
Yeah. Conan is less surprising because
right.
He was the later, you know,
because he was
more
cool.
Indie bands, yeah. And he was the cool guy. But yeah, Letterman, I'm sure Letterman probably said something like shitty and sarcastic.
Well, he probably said nice drums because apparently, apparently that's his running joke. Is he'll ask whenever the band plays, he comes on, he says, "Nice drums, are they yours?" To like
that's
every.
That's his dad joke. He's got to get it in.
Yeah, that was a crazy record, and I imagine it probably inspired a bunch of people going forward, you know, in the following years. Yeah. Number two is Orchid, Dance Tonight, Revolution Tomorrow. It's the Orchid record I don't listen to nearly as often, and I don't listen to Orchid a ton anyway, but...
Yeah.
I don't either.
Number four is Dillinger Fours versus God. Now, that's probably one of my favorite records on this list. D4 is amazing and one of my all-time favorite bands. I used to say this was my favorite D4 album, but I think I've probably grown to say either Midwestern Songs or Civil War, but this record's great.
I think I still prefer Versus God, but I do love Civil War. I mean, Civil War was actually really where I started with Dillinger Four, so that one's special to me, but Versus God, I'd say that's probably their best. Funny, I have a copy of Versus God that I found really cheap at a used bookstore that smells like patchouli. Really unusual.
See, there's that Jerome's Dream record. There,
a lot of screamo,
yeah,
right off the bat. Which I was wondering if this was like the rise, like the slow eventual rise of screamo. Was that like a late 90s thing?
This was that, what do they call it? Scrams era.
Right.
like number six is Page 99's Document 5.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge record. I guess this is that, yeah, this is that screamo was still kind of underground.
I mean, this is probably... Page 99 disbanded in 2003, so this is kind of like the peak year for, you know, the peak couple of years, probably 99 to 2003, I would say, or when you have the most active screamo scene in terms of like this style before it really made the mainstream crossover leap. And then of course all your kind of reactionary revival of the later 2000s. But yeah, I would say this is probably one of the biggest years.
I remember being really into Thursday around this time too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think one of their albums came out around 2000. We might see that later in the chart. I don't remember.
Yeah, I think I saw one of their albums on here.
Yeah, we do like to point out the trends, and screamo is probably one of the biggest ones on here, but we do see a couple of others. Zia, you said you saw one. Was it just screamo, or?
What do you mean? Like, I saw an album on here that was just screamo?
Or, as far as, like, a trend.
I'm sorry. In terms of trends. Yeah, on this chart specifically, it's funny to see how much post-hardcore and screamo is on here. And it's funny, I didn't really get into screamo until a little bit later. I think at this time I was still listening to a lot of wussy pop punk music. Like, honestly, like, number 7 is Flogging Molly, and I was like, oh my god, did I love Flogging Molly. But I wouldn't tell anybody that.
I loved this record. Like, I've said this on the show before, but at one point I discovered Flogging Molly, and so like I went and bought Swagger and Drunken Lullabies the same week, which turned out to be the exact same week that their third album came out, so then I bought that one too.
You were just in Celtic punk overload.
So I bought 3 Flogging Molly CDs in 1 week.
Mm-hmm.
But that's, to me, that's crazy. This is as highly rated as it is.
Yeah, it's number 7. That seems crazy.
I don't know. People love Flogging Molly. Like,
it's like the Dropkick Murphys phenomenon. Mm-hmm. Like,
yeah.
Just people would love those circle pits, like dancing at the side stage at Warped Tour, just going crazy.
You mentioned Flogging Molly, and that was one of the trends I wanted to point out. It's not necessarily a trend this year, but I know it is going forward for the next couple years. This is like the beginning of the gimmick punk bands.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You're just so like right.
All the Side One Dummy bands and like.
So was gimmick punk started by Me First in the Gimme Gimmies? Did they start it?
Well, you could almost say that ska kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or swing maybe revival and ska. Yeah.
Swing revival is probably more the culprit. Cause ska, you know, it has its roots going all the way back to like Jamaica and stuff like that. But swing revival, I feel like that and like the 50s kitsch vibe of the 90s, you know, like every punk band was wearing bowler shirts. And
guys, I have a confession, I was all in on this stuff. Huge. I loved the swing revival. Like, I'm gonna lose all my punk cred with everything I'm gonna confess to just you. I'm sure no one else is gonna hear this. But it's true, I loved it all. I thought it was so good. I think that's also probably why I didn't get into screamo so much, because I really did love like poppy harmony type of stuff, and that's why ska was also like an easy in, I think, at this time.
Well, I mean, I'm not gonna lie, I was definitely into the swing revival stuff in the 90s too. Like, one of my in my mind, worse, it's Christian swing revival.
Oh yeah.
I love the band The W's.
My god,
who are like bottom shelf swing revival.
Yeah.
I think my big swing revival secret that I just remembered the other day is that I actually bought a How to Swing Dance VHS tape off TV and would practice by myself in my living room. I still wish I had that VHS tape, but long gone.
There is a Cherry Pop and Daddy's album on this list somewhere as well.
You know, and I was going to say it wasn't as much of a trend. Like, all the gimmick bands weren't as much, but then I got to the second page and it's like, let me find them again, because there were a couple of big ones.
There's a Gogo Bordello record.
And there's a Bratmobile record. Or no, I'm thinking of Batmobile.
I was gonna say, you think totally Riot Girl is the gimmick?
Well, also like Living Dead is
more ska.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, no, please finish your thought. Oh, Millen Collin, there you go. There's your there's your skate punk kind of ska.
Yeah, there's a little bit of that.
We Less get than like Jake. There's an Aquabats.
Yeah, yeah.
There's Guitar Wolf, and there's, you know, there's some garage punk stuff going on, which there was something on the first page, too.
There's,
Well, I mean, there's a Rancid record.
Mm-hmm. Also, I mean, not to change the subject, but number 68 is the Jazz June.
Yeah.
And I loved this record, and I was really surprised to see that it was so popular, I guess.
Honestly, I'm surprised it's this low, because I feel like Jazz June have had, like, a resurgence in popularity. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, either they weren't that well-known back then, and maybe that's why it's only at 68 and not in the top 40, but I within the last couple of years, I would assume that would be within the top 40 alone.
You know, to me, that's the Jazz June record. Like, that's the one I listen to. So I'm really surprised, too, that that one's not, like, a first page.
I think it was also kind of hard. Like, even in the 2000s, like, I feel like my consciousness for what other people were listening to, like, it's not plugged in the same way it is today with, like, the access of the internet, I guess. Mm-hmm. Like, it's so easy to just be in your house and be like, oh, I'm really into Alkaline Trio, and it's, like, just me in the world. But then you look, and you're like, oh, shit, this is, like, ranked pretty high on here, so I guess I wasn't alone.
That's probably my favorite Alkaline Trio record, too. Maybe I'll Catch Fire. It's number 32. Ugh. Maybe that one or From Here to Infirmary. I'm, like, always torn between those two, but...
My God, I could do a whole podcast on Alkaline Trio alone. I love that band. So speaking of gimmick punk, like, when they would dress up in, like, corpse paint and come out on stage in coffins, like, please give me more of that.
Well, speaking of corpse paint coffins, AFI's The Art of Drowning is on here, too. Yeah. And I just watched the music video they had for that album, and they're doing the full-on Danzig, like, he's got a devil lock and, like, the weird ripped-up skin-tight shirt. And
I love it. I love it so much.
Do y'all remember that Hives album?
Yes. That was the one too. That I was going to say is your garage rock revival.
This is a good album.
I didn't listen to the album. I remembered that song, and I remembered seeing that album in the stores a lot. Was this the year that song came out? Like, was it pushed as a single in 2000?
I think so.
That seems right to me.
I told you so. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That may have been like maybe in the fall of the year, and that's why my memory is a little bit pushing it later. But this. It's amazing. I went through this entire list, and I found something on every single page I recognized. Like, even getting all the way back into, the, like, you know, the page 20, I still found some stuff in there that I knew, but I wouldn't say it was good, but I knew it.
Yeah, I don't know. It's so funny, because I really feel like 1998 through the year 2000 was such... I don't know if it's because... of our age, but I really feel like this was such an exciting time for music. There was so much good different music coming out. Like, even Anniversary is number 26. This was a great album. Totally different than everything else on here too.
Yeah, I'm going back even further. Like, I'm looking at page 3. There's a Casket Lottery album. There's Dashboard Confessional, Swiss Army Romance came out that year. It's number 94. I'm actually surprised it's that low. And then, like, there's Juliana Theory, The Movie Life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's... I remember this era, and I feel like I could spend a year just listening to everything on this chart and getting something out of a majority of the records. I mean,
I've been going pages back, and I'm, like, I'm up to page 5, and I see, even still, there's, like, a Blue Tip record, there's an Engine Down record, both great albums.
I'm trying to
Like that Mile Marker record is, you know, pretty well regarded, and it just keeps on going. And I mean, the 2000s, we've noticed this on the charts before, like, punk gets so much bigger. Like, there are so many more bands and so many more subgenres, and like, to where there's more records out than even show up on this list, because it just cuts off at a certain point, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking at the on page 4. I see a couple things that like I really remember from the time. Like 127 is SR-71's Now You See Inside, and I was playing that song the other day, and my wife was like, "I know that song." Like, and she's not into punk really at all. And it was because that was a huge song. What was that song called?
Oh my God, I haven't thought about this song probably since the year 2000.
It is. What is it called? Right Now. That's what it was. Mm-hmm. Right Now. There's a Goldfinger record on here, Stomping Ground. I remember that was like I remember seeing that in Walmart. Like, that showed you how big. That's the one with 99 red balloons on it.
Oh, God. So, also, when did Tony Hawk Pro Skater come out?
Oh, when did that first game come out?
That was, I mean, honestly, when I was listening to ska today, because I was listening to ska all day on Spotify, I was thinking about that Tony Hawk Pro Skater album and how good it was.
It was released in 1999.
Yeah.
See? So, nailed it.
August 31st, 1999. We probably didn't get it until it was out for a little bit, so we were probably playing in 2001.
Yeah.
So this is like exactly when... we would have been listening to those songs over and over again. Mm-hmm. I wanted to point out the Offspring are on here. The Conspiracy of One.
Right.
That's the one with the original prankster.
And I used to, it's funny because like I used to love the Offspring and then there was just, they just switched, you know, like they just kind of turned into a radio play band.
Yeah. Yeah, Americana was the last one I really listened to, which I did listen to it a lot, but that was 98, probably.
Mm-hmm.
And I would have been, I don't know, 6th grade, 7th grade, something like that. So I was, like, the perfect audience for
you were. You really were. You were like, skull with flames and some cool graffiti font, I am in.
And Sum 41's Half Hour of Power came out that year as well.
Mm-hmm.
That was... It had a single on it, but I don't think it was until the next album that they really blew up. Man, like it just keeps going.
Guys, it keeps going. Madball, The Vandals. You know, what's interesting, the album we're about to talk about is 162. It's like pretty far. It's like in comparison.
Yeah. Well, since we ran into it, I guess we could start talking about it.
Yeah, should we talk about why it's 162? I think I have some opinions on why it might be. So
Before we do that, I did remember to do this. So reggae music is kind of, with the genres, it's not the best when it comes to like including things that fall outside of the punk umbrella, but would be of interest to punks. So I wrote down a couple more that like that aren't on this chart, but did come out this year. Mm. So the biggest... The Weaker Than's Left and Leaving came out in 2000. Like, I don't know why that's not on the punk charts.
There are plenty of distinctly punk songs on that album for it to get included as a punk band.
Right.
I mean,
mm-hmm. That is one of my favorite albums.
Oh, yeah.
So good. I love The Weaker Than's. And they're, I mean, it's funny because they're like calm, but I still consider them punk, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it could just be the Propaganda connection and then the fact that, like, punks took ownership of the Weaker Than's.
Mm-hmm.
But also, Sunny Day Real Estate's The Rising Tide came out. I'm very shocked that album's not on this chart. Cause I don't know why it's not. Also, Jets to Brazil's Four Cornered Night came out. It's probably the weakest Jets to Brazil record, right, but it still deserves to be on the punk charts. And one I understand that's not on there is Lucero's Attic Tapes. I mean, they're not really a punk band, but, you know, punks love them. So,
mm-hmm.
And then No Doubt's Return to Saturn. Like, that was the other mainstream album, which I'm surprised isn't... I guess it was almost a pop record at that point, but...
Yeah, I'm also kind of surprised that that didn't make the cut, though, because I still kind of consider No Doubt ska at that point, but...
There's horns on that album.
Yeah, so, but I get it's in the process of transitioning to mainstream.
Yeah. And then Green Day's Warning came out that year, too. So that was another big one for 2000. But all right, now we can really get into our album. So this episode, we got number 162 on the album charts, and it is the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones and their album Pay Attention.
running this way is not the way we ever thought back.
So some quick basics out of the way on them. The Bostons are from Boston. So,
oh, is that why?
Yeah. formed in 1983, which I was shocked to see that they were around that far back.
I knew they started in the 80s. I didn't realize it was 83. That's...
I don't think they were called the Bostons in 83, but they were playing together. This is their sixth full-length album. It was released on May 2nd on Island Records. The personnel on this record. Okay, it's a ska band, so there's a million people who played on this record. We have Dickie Barrett on vocals, Nate Albert on guitars, Joe Gittleman on bass, Tim Burton, a.k.a. Johnny Vegas, on saxophone, Roman Fleischer on saxophone, Dennis Brockenborough on trombone, Joe Saros on drums, and Ben Carr as the Boston.
I am so happy you referenced the dancing man.
I watched the music video that they put out for this album, so sad to say, and I watched them performing that on Jay Leno that year, and he was going to town doing his thing.
I mean, he danced on the record, you just can't hear it.
Yeah. The Joe Gilliman was also in Gangrene and Avoid One Thing, which is incredibly underrated band. Joe Saroy, it was in the Street Dogs as well. This was Nate and Dennis's last album with the Bostons, and Fleischer's first. And the record was produced by Paul Q. Colder and Sean Slade. And they produced albums from the Lemonheads, Uncle Tupelo, Firehose, Radiohead, and Hole. So those guys have a pretty big...
Well, I mean, this is post-mainstream Bostons. Like, they're still on Island Records.
Yeah. So, Zia, why do you think this record didn't do so well?
Oh, boy. There's not one hit on it. We can start there.
Well,
I felt like no hits.
So sad to say, I knew that song.
I did know that song.
But yeah. I don't think it was like a huge hit. And, well, we could talk about that, actually. So,
well, I was going to say, it obviously wasn't a big hit because their next album was on Side One Dummy.
Mm. Yeah.
So they got dropped.
Island was very disappointed with the sales of this record. And I kind of get why it didn't do so well, because it was a ska record in the year 2000, and I feel like the mainstream was moving away from that, and in fact the Billboard charts reflect that.
Yeah.
So I pulled up the charts for the week that this album came out, and So Sad to Say is on here at number 20. I don't know if it rose any higher or if it's just, that was the highest it made it. But number one on there is the Red Hot Chili Peppers' Other Side.
Oh, boy. That was a huge hit, though, at the time. Yeah, I remember that was fast. Everywhere.
And really, looking at all the songs on this chart, I get why the Bostons did not make the impact. Because they're up there against Three Doors Down, Incubus,
Wow,
Korn, Godsmack's Voodoo. Remember, that song was everywhere.
Yeah. So I think what was happening is they came off the huge boom of Knock on Wood.
Yeah.
And so I think that that's why this maybe placed kind of high on the charts, because that song was everywhere. And I think that people were excited, and it was their next big album release after that, I'm pretty sure.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't doubt that people went out and bought it.
They, oh, yeah. I think they wasted too much time, though, because that album with...
That was like 97.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And this came out in 2000. That's like, that's too long to wait to put out another ska record.
Mm-hmm. You know, we got to keep that ska coming fast and hot, you know?
Because 2000, like POD's Southtown is on this chart. And Last Resort by Papa Roach. I'm like, we're getting ready to get into the full-blown nu metal. Like, there's Limp Bizkit on here. So...
Yeah, and it's interesting you say that, because today I read an article on the Bostons and how they played Lollapalooza in 1995.
Mm-hmm.
And they were on the side stage. Like, they were the only real ska band, I think, on Lollapalooza. But what happened was they just sounded so different than everybody else. They really made a huge impression leading into that song, and no pun intended, the impression that I get, which was everywhere. But I think that you're right. I think that it was the nu metal craze. Like, nu metal was starting, and so nu metal kind of, like, overpowered. Nu metal overpowered ska.
Yeah. I mean, even, like, the pop punk stuff, you've got Blink-182's Adam's song on here. It's number 2. But, and, like, Lit Miserable is on here. Yeah, but, like, as far as pop punk goes, what? There's not really anything else. No Doubt's Ex-Girlfriend was on there. And
is Smash Mouth on there anywhere?
Not on this one, but they probably had something that year.
Mm-hmm. I remember this was, like, a Smash Mouth time.
Yeah. But, yeah, Boston's, like, the only thing remotely like that. Because even that Blink-182 song isn't anything like this Boston's.
I mean, Astro Lounge was in 99, so they were definitely still playing All Star on the radio a lot.
What did everybody actually think of this record?
I'll let you guys go first.
This is only the second Mighty Mighty Boston's album I have listened to from beginning to end, in its entirety. I have only ever listened to Let's Face It, and even Let's Face It, I thought was okay. So for this album to have very little in the way of standout songs, I was not impressed, and I don't want to listen to any more Mighty Mighty Boston records.
Honestly, when I opened it up to, like, I listened to it on Spotify, and when I clicked on it, I was like, here we go. And then I went, oh my God, there's 16 songs. How are there 16 songs? And I was like, you know what? It's fine. They're ska songs. And I was like, oh no, they're all like 3 to 4, 3.5 to 4 minutes long.
This album is 51 minutes long.
No one needs 51 minutes of ska.
No, you really don't. And you don't need a 4-minute ska song. You really don't.
No, unless you're, like, doing some dub stuff, you know? But even then, those songs are not usually 4 or 5 minutes long. They tend to end after 3, because you can only do so much.
Yeah.
So,
so it was rough. We all agree it was a little rough to get through.
Well, I...
Oh, no. Liked
it. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
I
everything.
Kind of liked it. You know, I loved Let's Face It. That's the one with impression that I get. And so I was like, it's probably going to be more of the same. And in a way it is, but they kind of drop a little bit of the swingier elements.
And replace them with, like, 80s rock for some reason. There are a lot of really 80s guitar leads on this record.
It's true. There really are.
I mean, I really like the single, So Sad to Say. I like that song, 1 Million Reasons. I liked the first track. Dylan, what did you text me earlier today? You just texted me, let me be.
it was just like, let me be.
I did like that one.
He sings it.
It starts off like a little heavier, and I appreciate that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to say it's a perfect record, because clearly a 51-minute ska record is way too long. there are a couple songs I hated. Like, I hated that weird Dropkick Murphys song in the middle of the record.
Right.
Oh, you like that one?
No. I was going to say, I'm not going to lie. Towards the middle of the record, I think I zoned out a little bit.
Well, that's the weakest part of the album, I think, is the middle. So, like, starting with that weird high school dance song, which I'm still not sure what he was
singing. Oh, my God. And also, my note for that was, you want to know how old he was during this record?
40.
36. Which, I just think it's interesting to hear a 36-year-old singing a song about a high school dance that was really weird. And it ends with, like, robot noises.
Well, they were in the movie Clueless.
I was going to say, maybe he's singing about the scene where they played the band playing the high school dance in Clueless.
Guys, that was such a great scene in Clueless. It was one of my favorite parts.
I'm always shocked whenever I see it. Like, just that movie's on TV, and then you're like, oh, it's the Mighty Mighty Boss song.
Mm-hmm. I love it. I love it so much.
In a movie in 1995.
Yeah, because it was before Impression That I Get came out.
Mm-hmm. Which, that song featured in Chasing Amy, which they're credited on IMDb as a performer of that song. And I don't remember them being in the movie Chasing Amy.
Hmm. No, you know, I don't remember that either.
If they're in that bar scene at the beginning. But I don't know. I remember there was a band playing in there. Maybe they were the band, but not the Boss Tones. I don't know.
But also, that song, The Impression That I Get, was featured on the soundtrack for the Digimon, the movie, in the year 2000.
In 2000? That's so late. But I guess for a kids' movie, kids love old music, so that's fine. I would do to make this album better is probably chop out like four songs of the middle.
So the Irish song is Riot Down on Broad Street. That's the one. That was horrible.
I did not like that song. And that's like a fan favorite.
It is? No, it's not.
It is. No, I was on a Boston's message board.
Oh boy.
Research for this one.
Doing research.
You also frequent the boss boards.
And they had posted like a bad review of the record that was a poorly written review because it was written in list fashion, so I was like, oh, that's bad. But they were like, he just didn't get it, you know, songs like Riot on Broad Street and The Day He Didn't Die, those are like classics.
You know, I have to say, I wrote down The Day He Died is really nice. I wrote, it's a sleeper hit.
I kind of like that. I've read a bunch of reviews from the year 2000, and like three of them mentioned that song as one of the best songs on the album. Mm-hmm. I guess because it's like actually about somebody he knows who died, maybe a family member, I'm not sure. So I can see how that one could be a...
I want to say I didn't like that song.
What didn't you like about it?
I felt bad not liking it because it was clearly about someone who died.
Okay, I didn't like it either.
All right, guys, I see how it is. I'll go back to the boss boards with my real friends.
But, man, there were some other standout bad songs. She Just Happened.
Yeah. They still play that one.
She Just Happened. I had to look that up. That's in the middle. I zoned out. I don't remember this time.
Yeah. It's my lowest. Like, I rate each song individually, too. Mm. And I rated that one the lowest along with the high school dance song. So, yeah, those were the two of the weakest songs. Over the Eggshells was okay, but it's right between them. But it wasn't enough to make the cut of songs I would keep.
And what's the song about the guy who's, like, telling weird stories, like, things that didn't actually happen to him?
Is that All Things Considered?
Might be.
That's the All Things Considered is, like, a straight reggae song.
Yeah.
It's very polished. It sounds like it's, like, it was made for the radio.
Yeah, it's the older guy. We sure he fought in Vietnam.
Oh, yeah. That was a weird song.
Yeah.
It was like
a straight up. I did not get what they were trying to say.
I don't know. We like to hang out with our drunk friend who lies a lot, I guess.
I also put down that I hate the way his voice is mixed on this album. And I wrote that he sounds like a bog monster who smokes cigarettes.
I watched the video for So Sad to Say, and his teeth look weird in it. And it's only in that one video, because it wasn't like that in the others, but it was like they were sticking out too far, or like his lip was receding or something.
Hot takes.
That was an odd video, because in it, they're posters hanging all over the place for the Boss Tones, and which is an unrealistic scenario in itself, but they like... They'll move for a little bit within the poster and then freeze frame. It's just there. It was very odd. And then it would just show like homeless people on the street.
Weird. So weird.
And then they would cut to like an in-studio thing and they were on this plain white like background and it said the Boss Tones across the top. They're wearing their two big suits.
They're talking head suits. Yeah.
Really long.
Yeah, still clinging to that that 90s trend of wearing a suit that's like two sizes too big and just like tons of padding in the shoulders and oh no. So I remember thinking while I was listening to this record, like they technically sound good. Like Dickie's voice doesn't really bother me. I like that he has a gravelly voice and he's like in a ska band on the radio. I think that's kind of a fun contrast.
Then you'll love the Voodoo Glow Skulls. He's got a weird voice too.
They're all competent musicians.
I was gonna say yes. It's because they're all in their late 30s.
Well, true, but in terms of everything I've heard, I know the horns aren't exciting, but they never are in a ska band because it's always just like the band kids who started a band.
In this case, it was guys from Gangrene starting.
But what is your what are your ska preferences? Do you guys like a lot of horns like in your face, or do you like it more subdued like this?
So I guess it depends on what the music is. I guess for ska, I do want it in your face. But for anything that's not ska, I prefer it sort of laid back in the background. I like a lot of ska. Like, Five Iron Frenzy is one of my all-time favorite bands. Mm-hmm. So, and they had four horns? Three horns?
Yeah, they have like 10 people in that band.
Yeah. I noticed with the Boss Tones, I was surprised there's not a trumpet player in the band. It's two saxophones and a trombone.
Wow, no trumpet player.
So wow. That, and it kind of explains why they sounded a little different from a lot of other ska bands. Mm. Like,
two they saxophones don't sound... and they're not doing anything more interesting.
That's true.
You know, though, there's a trumpet player listed on their IMDb, but on Pay Attention, but maybe that was only for one album?
Yeah, I looked at, they, looking at, like, their, you know, Wikipedia does, like, that band member chart, mm-hmm. and they never show, like, a permanent trumpet player, so I feel like when they wrote the albums, they didn't write it with a trumpet in mind, so maybe that's why, and there's not, like, a permanent member of the band who plays the trumpet. Well,
there's Rolf Langsjoen.
That sounds made up.
No idea how to pronounce his last name. He's listed as the trumpet player on this album and on Jackknife.
Yeah,
he was Swan the next record, and I want to see, maybe he's on Let's Face It too.
I feel like that's a
no trumpet player is listed on. Well, no, there are a couple of, there are two different trumpet players on Let's Face It. So it seems like they just kind of like grabbed a trumpet player, you know, to record for their records, but they didn't have like an actual trumpet player in the band.
Yeah, that was my take, is that there's not like a trumpet player in the band. Yeah, they just threw it in for some, to fill out the sound of the record. But if that's the case, that would explain why the horns sound different, and maybe they weren't written with a trumpet player in mind, so I don't know.
Yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, because I feel like that's what I was thinking when I was listening to this album. Like, it doesn't, I mean, they are quote-unquote ska punk. Mm-hmm. I feel like the horns don't, like, hit you in the face like they would with something like Real Big Fish or Less Than Jake, you know, which was like all horns all the time.
Yeah. Well, remember, they're ska core. So.
Oh, that's right. They're ska core. Right. I'm so sorry. My bad.
They talk about that a lot.
They do.
They named their first album that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ska core, The Devil and More.
Yeah.
Which I had on a double 10-inch. Double 10-inch? Just make an LP.
So did they bring about the third wave ska movement? Like, was it really them bringing it?
You know, it's funny. I don't think of them as that band.
Even though
they've been around since the 80s. Yeah. Like, to me, it's like Operation Ivy.
Yeah, great point.
Yeah, they're probably the one that actually inspired everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I know, like, that, yeah, that first Boss Tones record came out in 89, and they had, like, what, four before they blew up in 97? So, yeah, I don't know how they, if they were a huge influence. I feel like it was mainly later bands, like Less Than Jake and Real Big Fish, and, but who inspired them? I guess that's the real question.
Yeah, I don't know.
Would it be two-tone? I mean, they don't play music like two-tone bands.
Yeah, I mean, the 80s ska bands, but that's the thing. I've always been so confused about the transition from, like, the Specials and the English Beat into Less Than Jake. You know, like, all of the 90s and 2000s ska bands that don't sound like that. I mean, Operation Ivy is, I guess that's really the link, but
yeah, probably that first CD sold them, you know, a crazy amount of copies, and I guess maybe some Asian Man Records bands, Skank and Pickle, that might be the one
maybe
that inspired a lot, because they were doing it too in the early 90s. So yeah, maybe what, Slapstick, MU330, yeah, so I could see it being those bands.
And that's the thing, like, I totally don't mind third wave ska either, like, and I'm sure you guys don't either, especially since, like, you loved Five Iron Frenzy, but
right, I mean, it's barely, if you think about it in the term, like, the sense of what ska really is, third wave ska really isn't ska. But
oh, I also, that reminds me, I wanted to out Justin as having had the entire discography of the OC Supertones. So, speaking of bad ska.
Yeah, I had every single OC Supertones album until they broke up. I didn't buy that last Worship record they made. So. But I even have had the greatest hits they put out in like 2003.
I just realized another transition band might have been Sublime.
True.
And that's definitely the mainstream.
Like, yeah, that's the mainstream.
As far as what gave Mighty Mighty Boss Tones a chance to be on a major label and No Doubt even, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Spiderwebs was probably the ska song from Tragic Kingdom, right? That was a hit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I don't know. Swing Revival, all of that. The 90s was a strange time.
Guys, I know that we have mixed reviews on this album, but I think we can all agree that ska was pretty great. Really was. It was like good people, like ska kids. When I meet a ska kid as a former ska kid as an adult, like they're generally a pretty good person. They're pretty positive.
Yeah, I mean, I grew up a ska kid, so
it sounds too happy.
Yeah,
like, the music is just too happy. You can't be a bad person and like it.
It appeals to like nerdy kids, I guess, too, which I definitely was a nerdy kid. So
mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that we all kind of were. Like, I wasn't a band kid, but I had a really, actually, my college roommate is like still the queen of ska. She's a stand-up comedian in LA.
Mm-hmm.
She loves ska, and she could probably talk about ska forever. But we used to go to ska shows all the time, and I remember seeing, like, I think one of my favorite things was seeing, like, an 18-year-old show up to a ska show in, like, a suit. I loved it. Like, an old crappy suit from the thrift store. Like, if you showed up and you were wearing, like, a tie and, like, wingtip shoes, like, I wanted to be your friend, for sure.
Was the corniness of it what kind of killed it? Like,
probably.
Like, everybody was so earnest. Like, I guess, but there was also like a costuming effect. I feel
keep going.
I feel like people in ska were more, compare it to like rockabilly, psychobilly. Like, with that, it feels like a lifestyle almost, where it feels more, to me, it doesn't feel as realistic. It feels like, I don't know, phony. But with ska, it felt a little more like, no, we really do like these dorks with horns and mm-hmm. all these bands playing in suits on outdoor stages. And
I loved it. And then there was bands like the Aquabats, which took it even further.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, the very same year as this was, what is that record called? Myths, Legends, and whatever, Volume 2. Mm-hmm. It's the one with Pool Party and Pizza Day. I mean, it's just a compilation, right? It's not a true album.
Yeah, but it's got stuff that wasn't really on any other album, so...
Yeah.
That's probably actually one of the best collection of songs by them.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least the last great one. I don't know, Charge was really great.
Yeah, Charge was great. Go ahead.
You can say what you were going to say, and then I'll loop back around.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I'm going to go see the Aquabats in a couple months here. They're playing in Charlotte. So I'm curious to see what the crowd's going to be like. I imagine it's going to be a lot of kids.
Yeah.
I think you're going to be wrong. I bet it's adults. That's what I'm thinking.
We saw them a couple years ago, but it was before the TV show. So maybe. We'll see. Yeah. It might be a mix.
I forgot about the TV show. I think that's the other thing about like ska shows and ska bands, too. Like, Aquabat shows were fun. Like, you went and you had a lot of fun at those shows.
Yeah, I mean, I've only seen them once, and that was, 2007 or 8 or something like that. But
it was like 2009, I want to say.
Mm-hmm.
And they were insanely fun. And I imagine even in the 90s when they were going, like, hardcore with the costumes and props, that they would have been even more fun.
So, mm-hmm. As ska fans, what is it about this Mighty Mighty Boss Tones record that just doesn't work? Is it because it's
not silly?
I feel like they try to be a little silly, but like, it misses the mark.
It just feels too safe to me, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's just, there's nothing that really stands out too much. Like, most of these, another note I had was, most of these songs I wrote, you can't skank to this.
No. Well, that guy on stage sure did.
No matter how slow, like high school dance specifically, I was like, there's no way you're skanking to this song. Like, you couldn't play this one live.
I feel like there's like something, it's so, it's so Boston too. Like it, I don't think of Boston as being a source of a lot of ska bands, and mm-mm. and like Boston has a little bit more of an aggro vibe to it. Like goes all the way back to their hardcore stuff, and like even like Dropkick Murphys, they're a little more, you know, aggressive than you'd expect from a Celtic punk band.
Yeah, it's interesting too because like he started in hardcore bands.
Yeah, Gangrene, like they were notoriously like aggressive and so.
Yeah, safe is a good word for it though. And really, it just lacks hook. I mean, really, at the end of the day, it just lacks memorable songs.
I'd say there are three songs with really good hooks, and then the rest are super forgettable. Which, you know, for an album to really click, you need more memorable hooks than just a couple. Yeah, I guess we could rate this so we can get into our EP. So our scale is 0 to 5, and you're allowed, we do like the quarter points between as well. So, Dylan, what would you rate this one?
Man, it's so hard.
Do you want me to give you some like ska horn thinking music?
I'm gonna go with 2.75.
okay,
maybe a 3. It's just very, very middle of the road, and it has some songs and some moments that I'm like actively annoyed listening to them. So,
well, I'm on the more positive side, so I'll give it a 3.5.
Because you're ska, that's why you're a ska kid.
I guess. I can't, like, I think I have a higher threshold, too, for, like, stuff getting on my nerves compared to Dylan. So, because I can listen to, like, I can listen to something bad and enjoy it because of how bad it is, but I think, Dylan, you get more aggravated by it.
I don't know. At the same time, I think I have more appreciation for like experimentation than.
That's true. I have no patience for experimentation.
I mean, I can listen to a jazz record. I don't think you could make it past one song.
I get bored, especially like improvisational jazz. No way. Forget it. I can't make it through that. Yeah. What do you think, Zia?
I think my gut instinct is 2.5. That's what I was thinking. 2.5.
I will say, looking at the Rate Your Music scores for all of their albums, this is the lowest rated album. It has a 3.14. Their next lowest is a 3.16, and that's the one that came out in 2018 called While We're At It.
Oh, you know what I totally forgot to mention? On some of the faster songs on this record, is it just me, or did it sound like later Hot Water Music with horns?
What?
No, I'm with you. I kind of agree with that.
Like, really? Just like the real mediocre mainstream Hot Water Music records.
Yeah, I felt that in some of his, like, particularly, like, Swamp Bog Monsters songs.
I didn't hear any of that. Maybe because I was hooked. Wrapped up in the sweet jams.
There were just a couple songs, and I was just like, yeah. All our music with horns. Like, knew what next with horns.
I wanted to say that I found a scan of the Billboard magazine article that reviewed this record, and on the very same page was a review for Britney Spears' Oops, I Did It Again.
Oh my god.
So that shows you exactly, like, in my brain, they don't exist at the same time.
No, this was just bad timing. Like, if they put out this album, like, a year before, maybe it would have been even bigger. But I think it still doesn't escape the fact that it was a little mediocre. But
yeah, I mean, even amongst Boston's fans, it's considered the weakest and has not been repressed since the year 2000. So.
Wow.
What are Boston fans called? Are they called, like, Boss Boys?
Shouldn't they be like Bostonians then?
Yeah, Bostonians. Against the Bostonians.
Oh, we're going to have the Boston mob come after us.
Oh my god. I don't want that.
They're connected.
The mighty, mighty Bostonians.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's get into our EP. So, we got number 35 on the EP charts, and it is Hey Mercedes and their self-titled EP, Hey Mercedes. Mercedes were from Milwaukee and Chicago simultaneously. I mean, I imagine it was one of those, some members live here and some members live there. They formed in April of 2000, and this was released in September of 2000, so a pretty quick turnaround. This is their debut release, and was put out on Polyvinyl Records, and the personnel is Bob Nana on guitar and vocals, Damon Atkinson on drums, Mark Dawersk on guitar, and Todd Bell on bass. So Hey Mercedes is basically three members of Braid plus another dude. The record was produced by Mark Haynes, who also worked with Braid and Raina Maria. Okay, so what did everyone think of this EP?
I thought it was fine. I wanted to be listening to Braid, I think, the whole time.
Okay, so I never really got into Braid. Like, I like Frame and Canvas. Isn't there one, Age of Octane as well? I like those two, but I don't really listen to them that often, and I never listen to anything before those.
I mean, Frankie Welfare Boy is not a good record. Age of Octane and Frame and Canvas, though, are great records.
Yeah, I think Frames and Canvas is my favorite Braid album. I think that was the one that really sold it for me. And they actually... So I read a little bit about like how Hey Mercedes kind of came about. And I think what happened was this was right on the tail of that record and they broke up. And I think they must have had some like, I have a feeling they probably had Braid songs in the bank and just continued them, almost rolled them over into this new project. That's what I'm guessing.
Yeah, because I think it's Mark is the only new member in this group. And he's on guitar. So I guess Bob probably wrote a majority of the songs. And they just let Mark do what he wanted guitar-wise.
Yeah, this record in particular, or this EP in particular, as far as Hey Mercedes stuff, sounds the most like Braid. The guitar playing on this record, I didn't realize how many of these like little guitar parts and riffs and were kind of stuck in my brain. Like, I put this EP on... Because I know I had listened to it before and probably listened to it quite a few times. It's been a long time, though, since I've listened to any Hey Mercedes. And, like, just first track, I was just like, whoa, that riff on Bells is...
Yeah.
That's great. That's, like, that's seared into my brain somewhere. And I did not expect that.
I don't think I'd ever listened to this EP, but there was a period there where I listened to Loses Control probably, like, once a month, which was their last album. I listen to that record a lot.
Yeah, I think that's the big one, right? That's the one everybody really likes.
Maybe. I don't know. There's the one before. I see that one a lot online. What is that one called? I should have written it down.
Their albums really run together to me because I got into Hey Mercedes not long after I had been listening to Braid, and so I just was like, what, probably a college student who would just like download entire discographies
yeah
of bands and then just listen to them all the time. So
Every Night Fireworks was that. The other one.
Oh yeah. And The Weeknd, I remember that one too.
That's the highest rated thing on their page, but it also only has 30 ratings compared to the other ones that have like 112 and 173. Yeah, Loses Control's got a higher score, so I guess that is the one. That's the one I like the most, so maybe everyone else agrees, but...
Yeah, it's funny, like, I loved that one Braid album, and then I do remember hearing this EP, and it just didn't, at the time, and it just didn't stick with me for some reason. I was, like, bigger into the Get Up Kids and, like, Saves the Day. Like, that stuff took me away from this.
Yeah, this has, like a Jimmy World vibe. Like, it's, like, really huge guitars. I mean, it's Radio Music classifies it as emo pop, which is not really a genre, but,
not really accurate either.
No, it's just, like, emo with a pop bent, but, I mean, I don't know, with the focus on writing bigger hooks than, because they also classify Get Up Kids and Saves the Day and Dashboard Confessional as emo pop, and I get there's a difference, and you would need to make a distinction between, let's say, like, Rites of Spring and Jimmy World and, what, The Pine? Like, they're all emo, but they're not really doing the same thing. So I get the need to separate them, but...
Yeah, emo pop, though. That seems emo pop punk, definitely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But that's, to me, that's almost more like a hyphen, like...
Yeah.
Situation and not necessarily a distinct.
I'd say like Paramore would fall into the emo pop more than.
Yeah. Maybe probably, not now. Probably more of the later, mid 2000s, like mainstream emo stuff. I would call that emo pop, which, you know, those bands were all influenced by, you know, Get Up Kids and
Lifetime.
Yeah. The Promise Ring and, you know, so.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was actually even trying to look up, like, what kind of genre Hey Mercedes was, because I couldn't quite put my finger on it, because I was like, well, it's not quite math rock, it's not quite emo, it's not twinklecore, which is, like, so much of that music was coming out of Chicago at this time, like Cap'n Jazz and, like, those kind of bands.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I did really musically like this EP, like, you're right, like, there really were some catchy guitar riffs in it. It's not my favorite Bob Nana vocals, I guess. I don't know. It feels a little disjointed, like this first EP. Like, it's not quite there yet. So it makes sense why, when they figured out kind of what they were later, why their later albums were more successful, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, what do we say? February is when they started playing, or April. So that's like, what is that? 4 months in there? 5 months? Mm-hmm. 6 months between, forming and this record coming out. So
crazy.
Yeah, that in the turnaround, that's crazy that they had that. They must have had a bunch of songs already ready to go.
100%. Bob Nana was like, "I got it, let's go."
He probably was like, "Well, these are the songs that the other guy in I don't know his name,
Chris
doesn't want, so we'll use them for Hey Mercedes."
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
It does have more than any Hey Mercedes stuff. This EP does have like, it seems like these were Bob's songs that were written for the next Braid album that didn't happen, and it so they just dumped him into the next band and then started writing new songs for the actual full length. And
yeah, because the other two Braid guys were just the drum and bass, so they can't even really change the sound of the band that much. And so who we know when they added Mark, it was just whoever they wanted to add to the band. So I couldn't find anything that he was in prior to this. He was in a band called Alligator Gun.
Yes, Alligator Gun. Big fan.
They're from Milwaukee. Maybe he's the Milwaukee connection.
He probably is. He's got to be.
They are. They were related artists. Dashboard Confessional. Who?
What is this web you just opened?
So it looks like someone in Alligator Gun played in Dashboard Confessional. Scott Schoenbeck. Interesting.
I mean,
but what does it all mean?
It doesn't matter who else played in Dashboard Confessional.
No, it does not.
It's 100% Chris Carrabba.
Mm-hmm. It really is. You know, with all this being said, though, I think I liked it listening to this EP better now than I did like when it first came out. I enjoyed it more now.
Yeah, I could see that. I mean, because there's a reason why Hey Mercedes isn't quite at the level that Braid is, as far as, you know, the way people view Bob Nana's bands. It's like a hierarchy of Bob Nana projects.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I would say all of the Hey Mercedes stuff stacks up better than the reunited Braid stuff. I just could never get into the No Coast album or any of those other. I think they had like an EP and they did a split with Balance and Composure.
Mm-hmm.
None of it worked for me. It just felt uninspired. It felt very much like a cash in, like, oh, people are name checking Braid, and well, I'm still cool. Mm-hmm. I make funny t-shirts.
Who makes funny t-shirts?
Bob Nana does. He owns Threadless.
Yeah.
Oh, that's why. Okay. I saw on Wikipedia that Hey Mercedes like reunited to play a Threadless thing. So that
mm-hmm. That's why.
I had no idea. That shows you how unplugged in I am with Braid. Like, they've never like clicked with me.
Yeah, they just didn't stick. And I think that loops back to what we were talking about before. There was just like so much. There was a lot of music happening at this time, so
yeah,
if something didn't stick, you could just move on to something else very quickly.
Like I said, there was like I could spend a whole year just listening to the albums that came out of the year 2000 and have plenty to listen to, and never go back to anything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What?
Well, I was gonna say this EP, it came out in the same year as Domestica by Cursive.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to think of your big indie emo stuff. I mean, there's Death Cab for Cutie record. There's The Anniversary, which we mentioned earlier. You know, that record stands out.
Yeah, I feel like all those records are more well regarded than this Hey Mercedes EP. I mean, it is an EP. It's an EP.
True. Yeah.
It's hard to.
But even then, comparing it to, you know, the first Hey Mercedes album in terms of. What do you remember from early 2000s emo pop punk? Hey Mercedes probably doesn't rank very high. So
true.
Mm-mm. No, I think it just got that Braid rub, you know.
Yeah.
There was a lot of buzz because of Braid ended. I feel like that album was really big too, and like they broke up pretty abruptly. So I think there was a lot of buzz about this being like the next side project. So I just love Bob Nana. Total babe. Have you guys seen his picture? Total babe. It's hard for me to say anything negative because he's a babe.
Yeah, he's pretty cute.
I don't think I know what he looks like. Let's see. Oh, I see it. Oh, yeah, definitely. That's not what I thought he looked like. For some reason in my head, he looked more like a Jay Robbins type. But maybe it's because they have similar careers. Like, he similar does a lot of, solo stuff that hasn't,
What did he do? Who is Jay Robbins?
Jawbox. And
Jawbox, right.
Burning Airlines. And what's his... Yep. He has a solo project that's got a name. Is that Office of Future Plans?
Well, it was, I don't know if that was necessarily a solo project, Office of Future Plans, because he's released the record this year under his name.
Right, but he had a solo project, sort of like Bob Nana's got, City on Film?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's a solo project, but it's him. And Jay Robbins has one, too, and now I'm blanking on it, and this is becoming a very long...
I mean, Office of Future Plans was a band. There were multiple members.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe I think it's somebody else.
Maybe it's Channels?
Nah, it's a band, too.
Yeah.
Nah, this is a pointless...
Well...
Bob Nan looks a little like Magneto. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, you're talking about X-Men, right? Yep, totally on board.
Oh, what's it? Like, why can I... Yes, he looks a little like Fassbender with a beard. All right. Well, what
how
should
we rank it? Yeah.
What should we rate it? I'll give it a 3.75. I really enjoyed the songs. They all kind of blended together a little bit. The first track, Bells, really just makes it all worth it, I think, to listen to.
I did get sidetracked for a second. I want to just send you this. I send it to the chat. When I Googled alligator gun, just the image results.
We got literal photos of people with guns and alligators.
I was just closing that tab and I saw it.
Mm-hmm.
I want to give this EP a 3.75. You know, it does run together. It is definitely more B-side material. Mm-hmm. The further you get into it. But yeah, I kind of want to revisit some more Hey Mercedes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was bracing myself for this episode, thinking it's been a while. Let's see how well it holds up. But yeah, I liked it.
Yeah, I'll go with the trend. I'll go 3.75. Why not? I found it enjoyable enough. And it did make me want to listen to other Hey Mercedes albums, for sure.
Well, all right. So, let's see. So, next week, we are going back 1 year and talking 1999. And we got number 114 on the album charts, and it is The Lawrence Arms, and A Guided Tour of Chicago. And our EP is number 121, and it's The Distillers, and their self-titled EP, The Distillers. Zia. Where can people follow you online and check out your stuff?
You can find me on I don't even know where you can find me. You can find me on Instagram, Zia Shoots Wrestling. There's some underscores in there. I'm sure if you type in my name, Z-I-A, it'll come right up. And really, that's it. Find me on Instagram or don't find me.
Yeah, I mean, you don't. No one needs Facebook anymore. I mean, we have one for our page, but it's purely just because you're supposed to.
It's true.
Well, awesome. Thanks a lot for doing the show. We had a lot of fun.
Yeah,
I did too. Thanks so much for having me. I really, I mean, honestly, even though I didn't love the Boss Tones record, it got me on this spiral of listening to a lot of good ska from this time period, and I really had fun doing that, so...
Yeah, we had originally planned on devoting the month of August to ska. We were mm-hmm. going to call it Ska-August.
Great.
In true ska fashion.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Great.
But we didn't realize that we needed to start earlier talking about ska records, and we were trying to line up guests, and we didn't want a ton of first-time guests to be like, what are we doing?
Why do I have to talk about ska? Well, guys, let me tell you what. Next year, if you get full into Ska-gist, just let me know. I'll be ready.
All right. Well, continue to follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. We're at PunkLottoPod. We have an email address. It's PunkLottoPod@gmail.com. And our website is PunkLottoPod.simplecast.fm. And, yeah, it was a lot of fun. And thanks a lot.
Thank you, guys.